for joining us at the table. My name's Fiona and I'm joined by the fabulous Rachel and Mary Ellen. Hi. Now, this week is like the Rachel Show. We have another Rachel joining us later on. Her name is Rachel Golding. She's the founder of Dinner on the Table. So we'll find out more about her business venture later in the show. You don't want to miss that. We'll also get the 411, the tea, on what these ladies think, who they would save in a burning building, your husband or your spouse. So that's going to be an interesting one. Stay tuned for that. Now, if you have anything you want to say about our topics today, hit us up on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and don't forget thetabletv.com is where you can get other of our segments. But first up, we're going to be talking about travelling with kids. Now, Rachel, you're always out and about, and I know you had some suggestions that we had in the At The Table magazine in the November issue. Do you want to share some of those tips that you had that worked for your family?
Sure. Well, look, the majority of travelling that I've ever done is mostly car and road trips. So we travel up to the Gold Coast fairly regularly in the car. There's five of us.
What's that, a 12-hour drive?
It depends how many toilet stops you have. So I think the shortest we've ever done is 10 hours. The longest we've ever done is 14 hours to get to the Gold Coast. So that's a really painful day. Once we drove and we took six toilet stops between here and Coffs Harbour and it just did my head in. But the key is I feel really anal when I do this, and that's probably the wrong word, but now I actually time when I give them water. I'm like, you can have water and we'll be stopping in like half an hour.
Is that bladder control? You even know how big the bladders are.
Otherwise, it's just a pain in the neck. But, yeah, snacks are important and activities are important, and my kids don't get sick reading or doing activities, so that works for us.
Yeah,
it's different.
Rachel, or any of you ladies, do you plan the activities that your kids are going to do in the car before you leave, or is it kind of just like a free-for-all, do whatever you want, you know, grab a book, grab pens, whatever.
Somewhat, yeah.
I've only ever gone on short car trips. We haven't had the privilege of having, you know...
Privilege.
Yeah, you're making it sound really exciting. But I think I just give Jax, like, I have a few toys that I send back with him, and then I give him a few snacks, but I'm really scared because whenever I go back there, the car seat's just a mess. But I think you just sign up for that, I guess.
Yeah. That's automatic, I guess.
You'll let some of those things go.
It's so funny because Brendan will clean the car and it will be, like, straight after, well, I guess even a 45-minute drive as opposed to a three-hour drive, it looks like there's been a party at the back because I've given them food. And I think that's so important. We have to have food in the car just to, you know, keep everyone quiet. And water. Water is definitely the way to go with us. And we count trucks.
I know that Jax loves music, so I think that in the future as he gets older, like, I'll see him kind of trying to keep the beat with music, so I think that'll probably be a go-to for
music,
me.
Music, audio stories we do as well.
Audio stories. Anyone that you would recommend?
Well, my kids have always loved Winnie the Pooh, like with Judi Dench, and those English characters love it, and they're hilarious. They've got good sense of humour.
You do see some parents with the DVD stuck behind the chairs. Do you encourage that? No one's got the laptop?
We do have an iPad, and I sort of use it, like, at the very end of the trip just to get us, you know, there. But other than that, I try and...
If you give it too early.
Yeah.
Has anyone flown with children or seen struggling parents on flight? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And how have you found... Did your kids travel well?
I've done a few flights. The kids were okay because we've only done short flights. But I've been on one flight on my own. It was coming back from Perth for work. And there was this poor mum there and her baby was crying. And you could just see all the passengers around just, like, getting irritated. Because it's not a nice sound. Yeah. Sorry, babies. But it's not. And at the end, I just went up to her and I said, you did amazing. Like, that's just such a rough gig. And she's like, thank you. And she just burst into tears because it's so hard.
Oh. Yeah. I'm scared. Yeah. I'm anticipating going to America and I'm scared. I should have taken Jax when he was little, but, you know.
How long is that flight?
I think it's about 14 hours and then another three once we get to the States. So I'm scared.
Yeah. I think we flew to Hawaii for their first birthday, the twins' first birthday, and they were fine, only because we had immediate family as well, so they were able to... I had extra hands. But I know that if they're... I read a story about a lady who had helped another passenger because they were doing the same thing. Yeah. Passengers were whinging, blocking their ears, and this lady had stepped in to help this passenger. And I think it just helps to have compassion when you do see someone, especially a parent travelling solo, struggling. Yeah. Compassion goes a long way, that's for sure. Look, from hitting from travelling with children to caring for our environment, that's where we're going next. Solar panels seem to be the new, I guess, that people are starting to investigate because energy rates are on the increase. Energy is rising at the rate of 8% more than our wages, which is why a lot of people are starting to look at solar panels. Mary Ellen, I know you've recently installed solar panels.
Yeah.
What do you think about them? Why did your family do that?
Yeah, so I think it's funny, every quarter my dad has this kind of a meltdown, you know, the electricity bill's $1,000, guys, you got to turn off, you know, because that's the reality for most families, it's about $1,000 a quarter.
Yeah.
So he kind of decided, you know, we're going to spend the money. I think it was about $12,000, and each house has a maximum amount of solar panels you can get. I think ours has about 4. So we got them, and we got our first electricity return, because what happens, you don't actually save money, you get money given back to you from the government from the electricity you give to the grid. So it's a bit of a backward system, I think. But guess how much money we saved?
How much?
So out of $1,000, we saved $7.
Oh.
Yeah, so...
How so?
I know, it was quite a shock. So when I'm reading about solar panels, I'm thinking, you know, they are great, but it takes it takes a little while to actually start earning money back, apparently.
Right.
And my dad's talked to other people, and apparently it's by the second or third
electricity bill. Because I was going to say, ours dropped by 70%.
So you've got solar panels.
Yes, 70%.
Yeah, and we don't have a battery, and I think the battery is probably the key to really dropping it down to about nothing. But that battery costs a lot of money, so... But, we've just got the solar panels. I think it was 3.
And why did you have the solar panels installed in your home? Like, what?
Well, we'd built a new home, right. And we were like, we made it as environmentally friendly as we could, and then we put those on top, and comparing it to our last house, which was over $1,000 a quarter, it's dropped by 70% that price.
So. See, I'm
how
just,
long,
I'm
how
just
long did it take for you to realise that?
Yeah, I'm curious.
I think because, we got them put on straight away, so from day dot. So it was really early for us. So
yeah,
yours will
lucky.
Be a bit different. Yeah.
So it's not only good for the environment, it's good for our wallets, I guess. So
It's good for our wallets, but the outpouring to start with is really expensive. $12,000 is a huge amount. If think about renters, like they don't have a lot of choice, or pensioners, like that's a huge amount for them.
I think that's what turns off a lot of people, is that big hit. But
it's
I think in the
hit.
Long run, it might, I guess, in your case, it has paid off.
In our case, we've worked out it will take roughly 3 to 4 years to make all that money back and then start officially
because
saving.
Because I can tell you, for someone who doesn't have solar panels at home, when I got the electricity bill of $1,000, I got a shock, like, what? And I called my electricity provider and was like, what's going on here? And they had jacked the prices up. And that, I think, is happening with a lot of families. We lock into a certain amount for a month, but then it's been increased without us knowing.
Is that a necessity, or is it sort of just like, hey, guys, you should buy some solar panels, we're going to put the price up? Like, I wonder why that is. Like, is it just the reality that we're living in, that electricity is becoming so expensive?
It is, because we're using a finite resource, and that's the problem. Sorry. Fossil fuels, when you burn fossil fuels, that is the finite resources, which is driving the prices up. And that is why people are struggling to pay. I mean, 145,000 homes in New South Wales are in energy debt. And some of them up to $1,500 owe the energy companies $1,500.
Yeah.
So the struggle is definitely real. People are finding the pinch. Rachel, do you have any saving tips in terms of like cutting costs for our energy if you don't have solar panels?
I think probably just being a bit more efficient with the way that we use our appliances and, the old turn the lights off while you're not using them and things like that.
Yeah.
But I think here what I've noticed in Australia is like all of the switches turn off. And when I've told my dad about that, he's an electrician. And when I tell him that all of the switches turn off, it's surprising to him, because this isn't a thing that we think about a lot in the States.
What do you mean switch off? Like, I don't understand what
you're saying. Like the outlets, there's a switch for the electricity to be turned on or off on your outlets. We don't have that in the States. So I think I've only had to be more conscious about it here. I've gotten a lot of comments from either my in-laws or my husband about like turn things off, unplug that, turn this light off. I haven't been as conscious about it.
Oh, interesting.
Interesting. And I think also apparently if you check with your provider off peak, and high peak and low peak or something, it can make a difference in what you're paying, and
definitely
using your appliances during those off-peak times.
It depends what sort of appliances and all the power usage that families are doing as well. Some use a high amount, some low, so it's all pretty subjective. But
Tell us what you think on Facebook, Instagram or YouTube about solar panels. But now it's time for Rachel, who's out and about building a cubby house. Let's check this out.
As a mum, it drives me crazy to see how kids can get glued to the electronic screen for hours on end. And just telling them to go outside and play doesn't seem to work as well as it used to in years gone by. It looks like I need to show her how to have some good old-fashioned fun. Let's go build a cubby house! A cubby house can be as simple as a large cardboard box or a blanket draped over a couple of kitchen chairs. The point is to get the kids involved and thinking creatively. Is this mine? Okay, that's my pillow. Well, thanks. So where are you gonna go?
Good girl.
Well, obviously safety is important. You don't want to build anything with heavy pieces on top so that it falls in on them, or anything too high that it might collapse. But other than that, go crazy. Kids can have so much fun building and rebuilding a cubby house and playing outside. Just watching them play will make you feel like a good parent.
That's where you are.
Oh, righto, I'll lie down here.
Oh, that was really cute.
It was fun. It was cool.
Did Tess enjoy that?
Yeah. She was out there for ages drawing on the cardboard and moving it around and playing house, yeah.
You're building a little engineer there.
I think so. Yeah.
I guess it's better to get outdoors than it would be indoors. I mean, my girls use the cushions inside the house and turn blankets in, and
it's just a shamazo. Too.
Yeah. Just creative, using
the
creative.
Messes, yeah.
Good stuff. Good stuff. Look, now we're going to be talking about an interesting topic that's caused a bit of debate. New York Times ran an article about who would parents choose to save from a burning building. Would it be your spouse or would it be your children? Now, there's a lot of debate around this because I guess people's priorities are different. Rachel, where do your priorities lie?
Thanks. Today. Look, I think
today. Depending on what happened with your spouse yesterday or last night, who are we saving from that burning building?
So it's the burning building. Well, see, depends what question you ask as to who, because I would answer differently for each question. Burning building. My husband's obviously an adult. I'm going to let him fend for himself. I'm going to grab my kids. That's it. Love you. But yeah,
and a lot of parents did. Apparently, in this article, a lot of parents did save their children first.
They don't know what to do, but yeah. So definitely. But if you ask me who I'd prefer to go out to dinner with, I'd be like, definitely my husband. I don't want to take messy kids. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's different for each question. So
yeah.
But as a general priority, though, like, it's a bit of a silly, I don't know, analogy, because of course you're going to save your kids. Your husband can save himself, of course. Like, but in a priority sense, do you prioritise your kids or do you prioritise your husband?
In
or do you
life
try
in
and
general.
In life in general, yeah. Right?
Again, a different
I think,
question.
First of all, we need to go to New York Times and say you're trying to create a lot of, you know, conflict in households, you know? I think that it's kind of crazy that we're even posing this question. You know, like, the basic building block of our relationships is our marriage, you know?
And that's what the article says. You're affirming what the article says.
Yeah.
And do you think...
I think first they're stoking a little fire, you know, with this a little bit of clickbait. But, yeah, I think that before there were kids, there was you and your spouse, you know? Like, you guys created that kid, you know? And I get the whole, you know, they can't fend for themselves. But I think if you don't prioritize your marriage, after a while you just look over and you just have a roommate. You don't have a husband anymore, you know?
I think sometimes, though, as mothers or fathers in some instances... When it comes to the children, it's the be-in and end-all. Mm. It's all about their kids. And sometimes the spouse is left hanging on the sideline. And so I guess that's where they were coming from in terms of, you know, where do our priorities lie? So I guess you've got a balanced relationship at home, you're balancing.
I mean, I think I can come on here and give you an answer that's obviously the right answer, but, you know,
what
it actually
comes down...
What does
reality look like?
No, reality, what reality looks like is that I don't have time to go out on a date with my husband. Like, I have time only to probably... I'm working all the time, you know, taking care of my son. Yeah. And then when it comes down to actually spending time with my husband, like, I'm usually working during that time. So I think we all know that the right thing to do is to prioritize our marriages. Mm-hmm. But when rubber hits the road, do you actually get that babysitter to, you know, watch your kid?
Amen to that. I mean, I think, I know that Brendan and I, with the children, when they came along, because we were together for such a long time, we were together for 8 years before we got married, 4 years before the kids came. Mm. So... kids were my priority. Right now, they're young and they need my attention, and I feed them and I change their nappies. So that will change, I guess, as time. But I think what's important is more so prioritising not only our marriage, but God in our marriage, because that helps things flow. Yeah. And I know when we've gone on our own tangent, which, you know, in marriages you do, it becomes, I become unstuck and we become undone and, you know, the chaos, really. So I think what we do, when we do, why we do and how we do it, we need to do it together and prayerfully.
Yeah.
And I'm just speaking from my own experience. I don't know what your experience has been in terms of prioritising marriage and what it really looks like at home.
Yeah, it doesn't look pretty a lot of the time, I'll be honest. Yeah. Like, I'm like you, I know what the right answer is, but the reality is before kids, it's so easy to just be with them, be around them. You don't even think about anything else. But when you've got kids, everything really changes in terms of how you spend your time. And by the time you have time for your husband, you're really exhausted. So it's a conscious choice that I'm not really good at making all the time. Mm. But it's a challenge.
Yeah. Mary Ellen, I know you're a well-rounded girl, you know, what example have your parents set for you in terms of stability and watching them as parents who love each other and, you know, nurture the family?
Yeah, one. I think one of the most important things for me growing up was seeing my mum and dad go to church together. And I think Sabbath was such an important thing because you don't have to work. Often, you know, you prepare meals the day before. It's just a day where you can spend together as a family. And I think that was one of the things that actually kind of, yeah, kept their marriage as happy as it was.
Yeah, so important. Look, I'd love to hear what you have to say. Hit us up on Facebook, Instagram or YouTube and share what works for your family or where do your priorities lie. But now it's time to get our food on. Gia and Olive are cooking sausage rolls, vegetarian sausage rolls, that is. Check it out.
So growing up in the 80s, we had sausage rolls and party pies at every gathering. And I wanted to relive that experience, but do it in a way where I don't feel guilty and it's healthier for me and my kids. And so here is a recipe I think you're really gonna love. It's so easy to do, and all you need is a food processor and all the veggies and stuff you see in front of me. So onion, one onion, one zucchini. You can double this recipe. It will make heaps. So one carrot, just throw it all in. You don't have to chop it up as fine as I did. You could just put two garlic cloves in and some, maybe a quarter of a cup of basil. You can add more if you like. And I'm using, instead of breadcrumbs, I'm using rice crumbs because a lot of people have gluten allergies and you can use gluten-free pastry as well. So just rice crumbs or breadcrumbs if you don't have them. Half a cup of the rice crumbs and half a cup of cashews. And in here I've got a teaspoon of sage, you can see, and a teaspoon of paprika. Throw that in there. And instead of salt, I'm using 3 tablespoons of soy sauce, which is gonna really bring the taste out. Okay, and here I have 300 grams of tofu. Usually tofu comes in the 300 gram packet, but I was just told by someone in our production team here that you can substitute for red kidney beans or beans instead. So you could try that if you don't want to have tofu. And now we mix until it's all mixed through. I'm just going to scoop the sides down, just a touch. Scoop it down and then just keep mixing it until it's really well mixed through. Try again. And I like to move my machine a bit. I know it could be dangerous, don't try this at home. Okay, so we're done. I'm going to show you the consistency of it. It needs to sort of stick together like this. Can you see that? Yeah. And this is a bit messy, but that's all right. Put that on the side. Now I've got myself some puff pastry here. You can get gluten-free if you like. And you just cut in the middle all the way down and across in the middle again. And you, I need a larger spoon. You put some of the mixture in the middle. You want a good amount in there, maybe 2 tablespoons in each one. Now these freeze really, really well. I know I said that before, but I actually use the plastic that's here, that actually comes with this plastic to separate each pastry. And I use that to freeze it and just put it in a bag, like a Ziploc bag. Okay, so they're not perfectly folded because we're going for the rustic look, but a little bit of milk, like non-dairy is fine, because this will give it a nice brown colour. Golden, I should say. It will be nice and golden. I put some sesame seeds on top as well, and I am going to put these in the oven and show you what they come out like. So our sausage rolls are ready. This is what they look like. So just leave them in the oven until they're golden brown like this. They're really hot now, but use any sauce you want, and because they're guilt-free, you can have 2 or 3 tonight and you can have them for parties and relive the memories.
I'll be definitely reliving those memories when I get home and make those sausage rolls for my baby girls. But now, Rachel Golding is in the studio with us. She is the founder of Dinner on the Table. Thanks, Rachel, for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about Dinner on the Table, the concept and how it all began?
Yeah, sure. Dinner on the Table really is a daily life changer, I guess. We do family-style meals, cooked. We deliver them to busy families all over Sydney, and we're really about trying to take the pressure off at the end of the day. When you get home from work, you're managing your children. You guys have all been talking about all of that. You know, dinner is one of those big jobs that you have to do every single day, and so Dinner on the Table tries to make that easier for busy mums. Mm.
So you're delivering meals direct to mums around Sydney?
Yeah, our biggest customer base are working mums, so people, you know, with children who, you know, they've got a lot of activities going on. There's a lot going on in a household on most days.
Yeah.
And so we deliver pre-cooked meals. They're big enough to feed a family, and all you need to do is whack them in your oven, warm them up.
I feel like I'm your target market.
Let us cook your dinner, Rachel.
What are some of the dishes that you prepare at dinner on the table?
Our most popular meal by far is our chicken and leek pie. It's really good quality hormone-free chicken. We use our vegetables come from a local supplier, so a farmer in the Hawkesbury region
of Sydney.
It's great
for the local economy as well.
It is good for the local economy. We cook it all from scratch in our kitchen. We make our pastry, we hand roll them, and they're ready to go from your freezer into your oven. Nice. So you get that pie I just cooked myself smell at your house.
So wholesome and wonderful. You just sound so perfect. My question is, what sets aside Dinner on the Table from HelloFresh or those other companies that also deliver sort of home-cooked meals, I guess?
Yeah, there's a couple of things. Some of those companies do deliver you a box of great ingredients, but you then have to cook it yourself. And what we find is that while that's helpful, you know, if you're really busy, you don't have time to cook. So Dinner
on the
Table.
That's the reality. That's the reality for most of us. You have all intentions of, I'm going to cook at home, and then you stop off at the takeaway on the way home.
Or it's just cereal.
Yeah. Cereal, you can do worse than cereal, I reckon. But so our meals are all...
cereal's right up there. Come on.
our meals are all cooked. But the other big difference between Dinner on the Table and a number of the other companies in the market is we're a social enterprise. So the big goal for Dinner on the Table is to challenge the way that people living with disabilities are supported in Australia. Part of every time one of our customers purchases a meal, part of their money goes towards providing a meal for a family living with disability. So we have a number of customers who order each and every week at no cost to themselves.
So it's free. It's free
for this family. It's free for them. Right. Free delivery, free food.
Why? Why did you think of, you know, reaching out to the disabled people? Because people, you know, we sometimes forget. I mean, you're just thinking of the mothers who are struggling, but you're also thinking of the disabled mothers or families out there, which is awesome.
So that's right.
Talk to me about that.
Sure. My background is in academia, in family and disability research. I refer to myself now as a recovering academic. but I spent years thinking about family wellbeing for families living with disability. So we're in families where either a parent or a child had a disability. And what would make a real difference to families? What would make them thrive? We know that some families thrive in the most extraordinarily difficult circumstances. Mm. But what we don't know yet is what pushes people up that thriving scale. We think that having a good dinner done for you at the end of a long and difficult day could be that thing that actually pushes you up the thriving scale. And I actually think it's probably true for any family, whether or not you're living with disability or not, and which is why we offer exactly the same service to all of our paying customers as our non-paying customers.
And I think it's so important what you're doing is encouraging Dinner on the Table, because sometimes we don't have time to sit on the table. Some of us are, you know, doing our work or doing our studies and taking our meals away. So that's good that you're encouraging not only family time, but also, I guess, help for those disabled families. Rach, you were going to say something.
Well, I was going to say, could you just take us a step back and tell us about that first dinner that you made? Why did you start?
Yeah, I was actually talking to my hairdresser, of all people, and she said to me, do you know what I really need? What I need are meals that I can just get the kids to put in the oven or that I can just heat up really quickly for the days that I'm working.
Yep.
She said her husband hated cooking. His answer was to get takeaway. She said, I don't want the kids eating takeaway. I don't want to be eating takeaway all the time.
Yeah.
It's expensive. It's not so good for you.
Yeah.
Can you make me some meals that I can just, you know, put in the oven quickly? And she knew that I loved to cook. And so that was where it started.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, I think I'm probably your target market as well.
Yeah. Let me cook for you, ladies.
Yes.
Except that my husband loves cooking as well. So okay. I think it is this expression of love. And I think that
I totally agree.
Yeah, it's great that you're able to provide that for women who feel like they can't provide that for their families.
Yeah, and we want all of our customers to feel like somebody has prepared this meal for me. They don't have to feel guilty about giving it to their children. They don't have to feel guilty about eating it because they know that it's been cooked with good quality ingredients. It's been made from scratch. We don't use any nasties. There's no numbers. You can read the ingredients list. You'll recognise everything on that list.
So, Rachel, do you cater also not only for meat eaters but to vegetarian and those of vegans and gluten-free diets?
Yeah, we do. We try to cater for a wide range of dietary requirements. We know that people have different preferences. We change our menu every week, so we offer lots of variety. We're always interested if people have got good recipes, that they want to share. We're always happy to try out new things. And most of the recipes that we've developed in our kitchen have come from things that I and my staff cook for their families as well. So they're good quality, family meals.
You're not just sending it out to the masses. You're actually eating the stuff that you
produce. Oh, yeah. Dinner on the table changes my daily life too.
Because you're a mother of three as well.
That's right.
And how do you balance all that?
I was going to ask the same thing. How did you find time to cook,
With difficulty.
Everybody.
And I can tell one story. I recently flew home from work really late. I had picked up the children from after school care. We were running late. I ran in the door and my husband kind of flew in the door at the same time. And I looked at him and said, I've forgotten to bring something home for work. And he sort of looked at me and said, you're joking. He said, the whole of Sydney is eating.
Sacrilege.
Except for us. Yeah, so it is like all working mums. It's a juggle. Yeah. It's a juggle. Yeah. But having dinner done for me definitely helps. Yeah.
Can I just ask, how many disabled families have you actually provided meals for? And how long has the company been running, actually?
We've been going for around about 3 years. And what I'm really excited to tell you is that we are just about, or we're just at 1,000 gifted meals. Wow. So we have
two families for free,
I guess. Yeah, that's right.
Families with disabled children.
Children, or with a family where a parent has a disability. We support a number of families where
parents
have
disabilities. What's been the feedback from these families for the services that you're providing?
Look, it's been overwhelmingly positive, I have to say. People are extremely grateful. I think they appreciate, just the time that it saves, the energy that it saves, that it leaves more energy for actually gathering around the table because you haven't sort of killed yourself in the kitchen for an hour and a half, trying to get it on the table.
So how can people get on that list of being, one of the recipients of dinner
or
on
support,
the table, if not
supporting?
Yeah, well, we work with a number of disability services that are local to us and they help us identify new families to start supporting, and we invite our gifted meal families to order enough food to feed themselves twice each week, and we pick up the cost for that. Yeah, so what we wanted to do was support people over the long term and provide really meaningful support to families. But we'd love to cook for anybody. So, please let people know that we, if they're busy and they're time poor and they want to eat well, we'd love to cook for them.
I love that. And so do you have a website that people can go to?
Yeah, we do. dinnerontheTable.com.au. We've also got a Facebook page. You can sign up to our weekly What's for Dinner next week email list. We send all our new customers a 15% off discount when they sign up to our mailing list, and we'll keep you abreast of what we're doing and how many meals we're gifting.
And it's in Sydney only?
It is in Sydney only at the moment, but we're looking for partners in other places.
Excellent. Oh. Look, Rachel, thank you so much for joining us and sharing Dinner on the Table with us. I hope we all become members. Hit us up on Facebook, Instagram or YouTube if you want to find out more information. We've had an awesome time chatting and I hope you've taken something insightful as well. Have an awesome week. Until next time, God bless.